tusks. Grains very specifically is a rocky outcrop region. So that means that large outcrops of hard rock are in the system and are mainly covered in invertebrate life, which is why we call it a live bottom reef. But you can see in these pictures taken at Gray's Reef, tons of sponges, tunicates, all covering these rocky regions. And also vertebrate visitors as well. There's lots of fish found in the system. And since it is in Georgia, Georgia is very hot. And that does translate to some warmer sea temperatures. So in this graph, we have on the y-axis sea temperature in degrees Celsius. And on the x-axis, months. So as you can see in these hot summer months, around June to September, we are getting increased sea temperatures. I would say the average is about 23 to 25 degrees Celsius for Gray's Reef. But during those summer months, we're getting as high as 30 degrees Celsius, sometimes with variance 32, 33 degrees Celsius on specific days. And interestingly, when we get a rise in temperatures like that, we're also seeing a drop in pH during the summer months. So this figure shows seawater pH on the y-axis, and on the x-axis, again, months. The blue line shows a pH of 8.2, and that is generally accepted as the global average pH of oceans. And the red pie charts at the bottom are actually showing the total percentage of measured values that are below that 8.2. So as you can see, most of the year, we are actually getting a pH below 8.2, and in summer months, around June, September, at the same time, with the same high temperatures, we're getting pHs sometimes as low as 7.9, which is pretty low for this area. You can see that right next to each other, when we're seeing those low pHs, we're seeing that rise in temperatures. So in a way, the system is naturally kind of mimicking what we expect to see in climate change. So this brings us to our specific study subject. This is Oculina arbuscula, and this is a temperate coral that's found within Gray's Reef National Marine Sanctuary. This is an image of it here. Right now, it's competing very well for space. So on those rocky outcrops, we have a lot of competition with sponges, tunicates, and other invertebrates for space. And this coral is very commonly found in Gray's Reef. We do know that this coral is resistant to ocean acidification, and typically in acidified environments does not have a decrease in calcification. We also know that this coral is tolerant to temperature increases. And generally, this coral is regarded as pretty hardy, and it resists a lot of changes and fluctuations. This coral in adults has never been subjected to these combined acidified and temperature variables in the laboratory study. However, like we just talked about with Gray's Reef, we are seeing those fluctuations in pH and temperature occurring at the same time. So with that, we think it's possible that Oculina arbuscula is actually tolerant to the combined effects of high temperature and pH because of the ecosystem that's found in Gray's Reef and the natural fluctuations it sees there. So that was our main hypothesis for this investigation. And with that, we predicted that calcification would be unaffected by these combined variables, as well as semi-autenticity and chlorophyll concentration. So for this study, we had three treatments and a control. For our control temperature, we picked about 26 degrees Celsius, which is about an average ambient temperature that you find in Gray's Reef. We also picked an ambient pH of 7.9, which is actually the lower end of what we see as a pH in Gray's Reef during those summer months. Our low pH was about 7.65, and that was just picked based on future projections of what we'll see in pHs in the next 100 years or so. And our high temperature was about 31 degrees Celsius, which is the upper limit of what we see currently at Gray's Reef during those summer months. In our tanks, we had four individuals per aquarium, four colonies per aquarium, and three aquaria per treatment, for a total N of three replicates. The colonies were subjected to the treatment for 75 days, so it was quite an extended time. And during that time, we measured calcification rate, the avoidant weighing, and at the end of the experiment, we measured semi-autenticity and chlorophyll concentration. So to see how the colonies responded to that first variable, example. We'll take a look at this graph. On the y-axis here, we have percent change in calcification for the duration of the experiment. And on the x-axis, we're looking at days of the experiment. And what you'll notice is this top line with the circular markers, that is actually our control. And this bottom line with the diamond markers, that is our combined variable treatment. So as you can see, right from the start, we're getting a separation in those treatments, and that separation continues to grow throughout the course of the experiment, to where that combined variable treatment is very much significantly affecting these colonies. As you'll notice, the line with the triangular markers is actually our low pH treatment, and that did not necessarily significantly affect the calcification, which is consistent with previous findings showing that calcification or acidification alone does not affect calcification on the island. But it seems like when we combine this temperature and acidification, it is significantly affecting it. And that can be seen here as well. This figure actually shows the total percent change at the end of the experiment on the y-axis there. And the letters indicate the significant difference. So as you can see, that combined variable treatment is significantly different compared to not only the control, but the low pH alone treatment. So overall, we found that calcification rate was significantly affected by combined variables. But what about symbiont density and chlorophyll concentration? This was a much more visible stressor. So the top images here are showing the same individual on day 0 and day 20. This individual was subjected to a high temperature treatment, and as you can see, over those 20 days, it is completely bleached, but it still has polyps extended, tentacles out to feed. It also, if you notice down here, there's tissue growth over the epoxy, so it is still growing its tissue. It's not necessarily very highly stressed. We didn't actually have any polyp death or colony death. And these bottom images show an ambient temperature individual, same individual, day 0 and day 20. And you can see there is a slight loss of color, but this coral is obviously very happy, polyps fully extended, tentacles out, and you can see there's lots of tissue growth over the epoxy here and even down onto the tile, which was actually really exciting to see when I was conducting this experiment. I thought that was the coolest thing that was growing on the tile. But these graphs here show, this bottom one is symbiont density on the y-axis, and that is in cells per centimeter squared. And the top figure is total chlorophyll concentration in milligrams per centimeter squared. And both of those variables were significantly affected by temperature treatment. So you can see it's a very obvious difference when stressed with temperature as opposed to at that ambient temperature. So overall, symbiont density and chlorophyll concentration is also significantly affected, but this time by temperature. So going back to our original predictions, we thought that calcification would be unaffected by combined stressors based on what was found in previous studies and what's generally known about temperate corals, but that wasn't true. We also found or predicted that symbiont density and chlorophyll concentration would be unaffected, also not true. So what does this mean? Well, we can conclude that the pH and temperature are clearly acting synergistically to affect this individual. And though previous studies have found that one or the other does not necessarily affect colonies, clearly together these are impacting Oculina arbuscula. With that, right now Oculina arbuscula in Gray's Reef is very common. It is very much a competitive colony in the Great Race for Space on those rocky outcrops. But I think in the future it could very much have its success limited by continued anthropogenic climate change and ocean acidification. As temperatures continue to rise and as the pH continues to drop, I very much think that the success of Oculina on those reefs will be limited. I'd like to thank the George C. Grant for funding this project, as well as the Honors Program at George Center. And then Lisa and Rob, very grateful for all the support.